you may have seen the banners here. There's two others out there in the foyer as we come in. I'm discussing a very sensitive subject this morning, one I believe is necessary. As time goes on, as an elder, I find out about abuse that's happened in the past. And it's concerning to me. One of my clients is the Children's Advocacy Center of Johnson County, and they're the ones that have loaned me these banners. And it's a discussion of issues that I came across and discussing this with the director of Children's Advocacy Center is a reason for the creation of this message this morning. There's three groups I am presently talking to. One, those who have been abused. Two, and what we don't like to think about, that out there in this group today, there are people who have abused. And three, all the rest of us, we consider ourselves to be Christians because we need to know about this issue and become involved. Genesis 5, Genesis 6, verse 5, says, "And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him in his heart." Anybody know when this was written, what event was about to take place? Right before the flood, he's talking about the antediluvians. Okay? Luke 17, verse 26 says, "And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all." You notice he's talking about there's not going to be any difference between those times that Noah had before the flood and before the Son of Man comes. And what are we looking forward to at this present time? The Son of Man coming. We see all the signs that we are at the end. And unfortunately, some of these abuses that are just one of those signs. We see in Luke 17:28, "Likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed." We are standing right at the threshold of troublous times. Do we see wickedness in the world around us today? Are the thoughts of man evil continuously? They are. All you have to do is watch the news. And unless you're burying your head in the sand, it's very present around us. If you have been looking in your bulletins recently, you'll see that anyone in this church that works with young people is required to take a course called Shield the Vulnerable. And that course is on child abuse and how to spot predators. And it's my personal belief that each and every one of us should take that course.
Amen.
Because it is prevalent in the world today. Matthew 19, verse 14 says, "But Jesus said, Suffer, little children, and forbid them not to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of heaven." Now, as we look at the Gospels, we'll see things that Matthew brings out that Mark doesn't talk about. We'll then see things Mark brings out that Matthew doesn't talk about, especially with Luke. But when it comes to this verse, every one of the Gospels remarks on it. Children are very special to God. That faith, that innocence are important. And it's important that we have the same thing. And we know that Satan is trying to destroy the family unit out there. And it would appear that he's doing a very good job. Now, in order to illustrate how pertinent this subject is to all, I want to give you a few statistics. I don't know if you have seen this banner next to me. And you may not be able to read it, especially in the back. So I'm going to give you some statistics that are probably going to shock you. One in four girls before they're 18 will be abused. One in six boys before they're 18 will have been abused. Let that sink in. In this case of girls, 25% of the girls that are 18 here will have been abused. So that tells me that in your midst are young women and young men who have been abused. That astounds me and it scares me. In the United States, 5 people a day die due to abuse. 5 a day. Less than 10% of the time is it ever a stranger. Over 90% of the time it is a family member or one they have developed a relationship with that does the abuse. Now what about here in Johnson County? When I talked to Tammy about the problem here, she gave me this next statistic. Here in Johnson County, it has been less than 2% that the abusers are strangers to each other. Awesome statistics, aren't they? And it tells you that not only are there abused in the congregation today, but there's also a possibility that there are abusers. And that's why we're required to go through the Shield the Vulnerable course and learn some of these signs. And I believe I need to go back through the course because I know I don't have the best memory. Some of these things have passed from me. Now there are 4 basic forms of abuse. And the first one is one we've all heard about, and that is sexual abuse. And because of the venue and the children present, I'm not even going to delve into that issue today. But if you have internet access and you care to go do some research, and read some of the stories of those that have been abused, or listen to some of them, because there are videos out there of these young people that have been abused. If you have a heart at all, it'll make you cry, I guarantee you. The second form of abuse is physical abuse. We all have heard about that. The hospitals are warned to be on the alert. The people with these things, these signs of physical abuse. The only thing that I really want want to talk about in physical abuse is an issue that I believe people today misunderstand. And I'll touch that when I get done with the fourth one here. The third type of abuse is emotional abuse. That's where we're going to spend my time this morning, because it's better suited for this group, and also I believe there's more ignorance when it comes to emotional abuse as than any other type of abuse. And the last one is just sheer neglect. And I'm not really going to spend time there. The word alone says enough. And in the emotional abuse, I'm going to cover some on neglect. But what I would like to bring out from physical abuse is that this misunderstanding we have, and that is that spanking or controlled spanking is physical abuse. And in the majority of the states in this country, spanking is not considered physical abuse. So let's just take a minute to take a look at a little bit of scripture written by the wisest man that lived, according to the Bible, Solomon. And he tells us in Proverbs 13, verse 24, that he that spareth his rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. Proverbs 22:15, foolishness is found in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it far from him.
Amen.
Proverbs 29, verse 15, the rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself bringeth his mother to shame. Now I have heard pastors say, the rod spoken of here, it is the rod that the shepherd carried that he used to guide his sheep along. And I don't believe that that's what these verses is talking about. And I'm going to show you why I don't believe that. If we just go to the Strong's Concordance and look at the word rod in all three of this is the same word, by the way. And it comes from the word shabbat, from an unused root, probably meaning to branch off, a scion, literally a stick for what? Punishing, writing, fighting, ruling, walking, etc., or a clan. You notice it said in there that this could be a clan. We have a policy here because of the shepherd's rod. That is a type of clan. But it's used here. This is how the King James interprets the word as correction. A dart, a rod, a scepter, a staff. And as for some of these ministers, I believe that the staff comes in, or a tribe, again, shepherd's rod. Now, you say, well, that could be iffy either way, couldn't it? But let's go back here to Proverbs again. Proverbs 23, verse 13. Proverbs 23, verse 13 says, withhold not correction from the child, for if thou beatest him with the rod, he shall not die. And I'm going on, thou shalt beat him with the rod and shalt deliver his soul from hell. Now, I don't believe in feeding them with a rod. The controlled corporal punishment is in line for our children. And if any of you have heard Doug Batchelor talk about his early years, you have heard him say that he thought the best years were when he was sent to military school, because he had that protection, that guidance, that discipline in his life. And one of the reasons we see the problems that we see today is because there's not enough discipline in the lives of our children.
Amen.
Now, there are six well-known types of emotional abuse. And I'm going to have to run through these pretty quickly. We're speaking to a diverse audience here, and every one of our minds processes things differently. We can all go to a presentation and we all come back with different things. So some of the points I bring out, I'm not even going to spend any time on. They may not be pertinent to me, but they may be very pertinent to you. But these are all forms of emotional abuse. The first one that we run into is purely rejecting. Parents or caregivers who display rejecting behavior toward a child will often purposefully or unconsciously let a child know in a variety of ways that he or she is unwanted. Putting down a child's worth or belittling their needs is one form these types of emotional abuse may take. Other examples can include telling a child to leave, or worse, get out of my face. Calling him names or telling the child that he is worthless, making a child the family scapegoat, or blaming him for family or sibling problems, refusing to talk to or holding a young child as he grows can also be considered abuse. And those of you that are in the medical profession or have heard some of the things on the news know that the hospitals are now making sure that the mothers get to hold children, even if it seems like the inevitable death is there. They let the mothers hold the child because it can make such a difference. Mm-hmm. Love. God is love. And our children need love, not abuse.
Amen.
So let's go through some forms of rejecting. Constant criticism. Name calling. Telling a child he or she is ugly. Yelling or swearing at a child. And I doubt that there's anyone here who hasn't been in a store out there in public that hasn't seen a parent screaming at a child. That is a form of child abuse. And maybe you never thought of it. Maybe you're one of those who has done such a thing. Frequently belittling and use of labels such as stupid or idiot. Now, I myself have suffered from this. My father was an alcoholic. And he had very little effect on my life. He was not there most of the time drinking. And when he was there, it was all negative. And I was told over and over again that I'd never amount to anything. My name was Rattlebrain to him. Those things have effect on our lives. Constant or demeaning jokes. Verbal humiliation. Constant teasing about a child's body type and or weight. Now, we have a problem in this world today with obesity. And we can help counsel our children on the health message for their weight. We need to be careful on how we do it. More forms of rejection. Expressing regret the child wasn't born the opposite sex. Now, I received this. My parents wanted a girl. And I heard about it. Matter of fact, my little brother thought it was great fun that his older brother was supposed to be Beverly Ann. Turned out to be Thomas Richard instead. That is, he thought it was great fun until he was enlightened with the fact, since I wasn't Beverly Ann, he was supposed to be. So we all The second two of us did. The first one, he was fun because he was a boy. This is one of my favorites, refusing hugs and loving gestures. I can't tell you how many people I've talked to that grew up in homes where they said love just wasn't there. That's important to a child to see these things. Physical abandonment. I know of a man who is not present here today, but has been in this congregation in the past, who went out with his friends to play one day. And he was gone all day. And when he came back home, all his belongings were sitting there on the curb. His parents had moved. Think what that does to a child. No child deserves abuses like this. Excluding a child from family activities. This often happens if we have a child that has mental handicaps or physical handicaps. We need to take them into consideration too. Treating an adolescent like he is a child. And this goes beyond childhood abuses, because I know of cases where adults have treated their spouse like they were a child. And that's a form of abuse too. Expelling the child from the family, not allowing the child to make his own reasonable choices. All these are things that have to be present in the child's life. It's a form of rejection. Let's go on to our second form, and that is ignoring. Adults who have had few of their emotional needs met are often unable to respond to the needs of their children. They may not show attachment to the child or provide positive nurturing. They may show no interest in the child or withhold affection or even fail to recognize the child's presence. Many times a parent is physically there, but emotionally unavailable. Failing to respond or interact with your child constantly or consistently constitutes emotional and psychological abuse. We see this often in cases of alcohol or other chemical abuse, drugs, whether they be prescription drugs or illegal drugs. The child's there, and the parent's just out of it. And that is one of the worst forms of abuse, as far as I'm concerned. So let's look at how these forms are of ignoring. No response to infants, spontaneous social behavior. Now, I don't know about you, but my daughter fascinated me. And I love to see how she interacted with things. But there are people out there, like my father was, that could care less than what went on in my life. Failure to pay attention to significant events in a child's life. Perhaps they aren't even there for a birthday. Perhaps you're out at that baseball game and they don't show up. Or something, you got an A on a paper at school. They don't want to hear about it. All these things come into play. Lack of attention to your schooling or your peers. Refusing to discuss your child's activities or interests. I mean, isn't it wonderful when a parent wants to listen to you and hear what's going on? Planning activities or vacations without including your child. I can't even imagine leaving your child planning on vacation. accepting the child as an offspring. And I think this can happen in these second family situations where the youth, non-parent, just rejects the child. I'm told that happens in normal situations as well. Denying required health care. And I've heard of these, but this next one, denying required dental care, I've run into. Now, I loved candy as a child. I ate too much of it. We didn't have fluoride toothpaste around. I had my share of cavities. So I've got a lot of fillings in my mouth. But one of my clients up in Hot Springs was a pediatric dentist. And it tore my heart how parents could neglect their children. Because there were times he had before and after photos. And children's teeth were rotted out to the gum line before he ever got to see them. Because the parents were hoping they'd just fall out and the new teeth would come in. I don't know about you, but I've had toothaches. And they're not pleasant. And I can't imagine what those children went through. Failure to engage a child in day-to-day activities. Leave me alone, I'm reading my newspaper. Or I'm watching my favorite soap on TV. Not taking part with your kids at all. And in this one, failure to protect a child. And this one is often run into in abusive home situations. The one parent is abusing the child, and the other parent, because of fear of losing that parent, doesn't do anything, takes no action at all. And I'm sorry, but I believe that's just criminal.
Amen.
Amen. Let's go on to our next type of emotional abuse, and that is terrorizing. Parents who use threats, yelling, and cursing are doing serious psychological damage to their children. Singling out one child to criticize and punish, or ridiculing him or her for displaying normal emotions, is abuse. Threatening a child with harsh words, physical harm, abandonment, or in extreme cases, death, is unacceptable. Even in jest, causing the child to be terrified by the use of threats and or intimidating behavior is some of the worst emotional abuse. This includes witnessing, hearing, or knowing that violence is taking place in the home. So some of the forms of terrorizing are excessive teasing. Now, I don't think there's anyone here who hasn't been teased. And I love to tease, and I can take a good teasing. The key word here is excessive. When you're on them all the time, that's just not right. Yelling, cursing, or scaring. You know, when we discipline our children, we need to have a calm down and talk rationally. Yelling doesn't solve anything. Unpredictable and extreme responses to a child's behavior. Extreme verbal threats. Raging, alternating with periods of warmth. And I know of a situation in this church where that was the case. That the person acted loving and friendly, but then would just go off. We need to pray for people like that. We need to be there to help them. Threatening abandonment. In the case of that person I told you before, it went beyond a threat. They just left. But threatening abandonment, can you imagine how you as a child would feel if your parents said, You don't change. We're living. I can't imagine. You know, thinking about that, I think of our own Pat Chastain. She's been a foster parent. She didn't see some of the foster parents. They had over 100 go through their homes. I bet you she could tell you some good stories about the abuse of situations. Berating family members in front of or in near range of a child. And that word berating, some of you may not be familiar with it, that's just screaming again. Shouldn't have peace in the house. With my dad being an alcoholic, there were horrible fights, there were arguments going on all the time. I used to have horrible nightmares, and they didn't go away until I graduated from high school and joined the military and got out of the house. And is that screaming? Rating wasn't there any longer. Threatening to destroy a favorite object. But key that with the next one. Threatening to harm a beloved pet. One of those case studies I read involved this very thing. And the next step. Forcing child to watch an inhumane act. Not because children are young, but they're going to the details now. Compare that one with the one above it and think of sacrifices in the Old Testament times. And that's what happened to a child. She had to watch that. Inconsistent demands on a child, displaying inconsistent emotions, this loving at one moment, raging at another, changing the rules of the game. We set out rules for you here, but tomorrow, because of something you did, I changed those rules entirely. The child doesn't know how to respond to those changes. Threatening that a child is adopted or doesn't belong, ridiculing a child in public, threatening to reveal intensely embarrassing traits to peers. And I've heard of this one. I heard of a child who was having trouble with potty training. And the parents didn't like the fact that at night they had to be on a diaper. Said, you should be old enough to be over this. If you don't stop wetting that diaper at night, we're going to tell all your friends that you're still doing it. Can you imagine the trauma that would bring to that child? Threatening to kick an adolescent out of the house. This tie in with the one we had before. Children and youth who witness family violence experience all six types of emotional abuse we're going to talk about this morning. So these things are just all part of it. Just one. Now we're going to go on to our fourth form of abuse, and that's one that's amazing to me, and that's isolating. A parent who abuses a child through isolation may not allow the child to engage in appropriate activities with his or her peers, may keep a baby in his or her room, not exposed to stimulation, or may prevent teenagers from participating in extracurricular activities. Requiring a child to stay in his or her room from the time the school lets out until the next morning. Restricting eating or forcing a child to isolation or seclusion by keeping her away from family and friends can be destructive and considered emotional abuse depending on circumstances and severity. I don't think it needs to depend on the circumstances. There is a series of books that came out years ago called Flowers in the Attic about a woman who lost her husband and didn't have anything. And her mother said, I'll take you in, but not your kids. Because I have a social life, and that doesn't include little brats hanging around. So the daughter moved in, and the children went mad. They lived in the attic. They were fed in the attic. That's about it. The mother would come up and talk to them when she gave them the food. And that was about it for years. It's based on a true story. One of the case studies I read was one of these situations where the child would go to school and all of his friends thought everything was fine, and he'd go home from school and he was put in a closet. That's where he lived when he wasn't in school. That's where he took his meals. That's where he slept. And he had a pot to go to the bathroom in. Totally excluded from the family. These things happen in the world around us. To me, it's frightening. Our forms of isolating the child come from leaving the child unattended for long periods of time. There are parents that will go off to work with little children, with no babysitters, just on their own. They will keep a child away from the family, like in the case of this boy locked in the closet. They will not allow a child to have friends, or they will not permit a child to interact with other children. And we need that for our children, for the development of social skills. Rewarding a child for withdrawing from social contact. Ensuring that a child looks and acts differently than peers. We have to be careful that, first of all, we need to watch who the peers are for our children, make sure they're the right type of friend for them. But we need them to be able to look like them and act like them. Isolating a child from peers or social groups, insisting on excessive study and or chores, and you notice the word excessive, because our children need to know that they need to go and do their homework. They need to know that they have chores. Mrs. White talks strongly about that. It's all part of developing responsibility. But excessive is what we're talking about here, and we'll talk about it a little bit more as I go on. Preventing a child from participating in activities outside of home, punishing a child for engaging in normal social experiences. These are all forms of isolation. The next point we look at is corrupting a child. And I'm sure you've heard of some of this on television recently. Parents who corrupt may permit children to use drugs and alcohol, watch cruel behavior towards animals, watch or look at inappropriate sexual content, or to witness or participate in criminal activities such as stealing, assault, prostitution, gambling, etc. Encouraging an underage child to do these things that are illegal or harmful is abusive and should be reported. Now, I'm sure you've heard of cases across this nation where teachers have been found to have sexual relationships with students. I'm sure you've heard right here in the DFW area about that lady that had a party for her teenage son and his friends, and they had pot and alcohol, and she engaged in sex with some of his friends. That's all part of this corrupting, and should not be tolerated. Forms of child corruption.